Good evening, everyone. Welcome, welcome. Thank you all very much for being here. My name is Russell Shorto. I'm the director of the John Adams Institute, which is an independent American culture center based right here in this building. This is actually the 25th anniversary of the John Adams Institute, so happy birthday, John Adams Institute. And for 25 years, the Institute has been doing a variety of things to promote the connections between the Netherlands and the U.S. The main thing, however, is this, bringing American speakers to the Netherlands to talk to Dutch audiences, sometimes filmmakers, politicians, others, but more often than not, writers, to discuss their books, to talk about ideas. And I'm very pleased to have Deborah Scroggins and have this event. And I normally, so those of you who are familiar with our events will know that the way things will probably proceed, although you never know, is there will be a talk for maybe 20, 30 minutes. There will be then a moderated discussion and then involvement in the form of questions and comments from anyone who cares to participate. And then Deborah will sign books. Before I introduce the moderator, though, I just want to say that this is quite special for me because it's a bit coming full circle. I came to Amsterdam in 2005, and shortly after coming, I met Deborah in Zuid, where we were both standing in front of the school enrolling our daughters. And we were both writers, both Americans, both had come here to research books originally. And so life happens in the intervening years. Your children become friends. Lots of things happen. And then, lo and behold, here we are, and her book is out, and I'm in this position, and it's wonderful to be able to welcome her here. We have a distinguished moderator as well. Petra Stienen is well known to many of you. She studied Arabic and Middle Eastern studies. She worked for almost 10 years in the Arab world for the Dutch Foreign Ministry. And she is now working independently as a writer and an advisor. She writes for the NRC Handelsblatt and for the Volkskrant. She has a column in Opzij, and she regularly appears as a commentator on television and radio, and particularly, and notably, I would say, on Pauw en Witteman and Eén Vandaag, talking about topics like the Arab Spring and, more recently, Syria. Last month, she was honored with the Women in the Media Award for 2011. Please welcome our moderator, Petra Stienen.
Thank you, Russell. International Women's Day, 8th of March. What a great, great moment to talk about two women who took space as an activist, as a... Well, I'll leave the labels to you, Deborah. But two women, you know, I think in the International Women's Day, we talk about women who dare to take space in politics, in media, in culture. And sometimes people don't like it when women take space because we suspect them of things. Sometimes we admire them. This morning I was in The Hague in Société de Witte. For those of you who don't know this, until 1998, women were not allowed in this establishment, so thank God some women dare to take space. Deborah and I just met, we had a lovely dinner, so we're on first names basis, and I have to tell you, it was such a pleasurable weekend, last weekend, when I read your book. It is a detective, it is life stories, sometimes I was upset, shocked, inspired. I happen to have met Ayaan Hirsi Ali a couple of times in conferences. I've always admired her for her outspokenness. I've been accused myself as a diplomat to have been outspoken a little bit too much, so when I see somebody doing what she did, I find it an inspiration. I have never met Aafia, obviously, but I've lived in the Arab world and I've seen women, like both of the women you described. Deborah Scroggins is a well-established journalist, ladies and gentlemen. She is an author, and I think having read her book and having spoken to you, for the past 2 hours. I am sure we will have a delightful evening. Could I please invite you to the floor? Please, a warm applause for Deborah.
Thank you, Petra, and thank you, Russell. Very generous introduction. I really appreciate it. And thank you all for coming out tonight on International Women's Day. It's great to be here in Amsterdam again. So, Islam is at war with the West. Not everyone agrees with this proposition, but the two subjects of my book who disagree on virtually everything else agree on this point. The first is Ayaan Hirsi Ali, who, as probably everyone here already knows, is the Somali-born best-selling author and former Dutch Member of Parliament. She was notoriously threatened with death for her criticisms of Islam. The second is less well known in the West, although she is revered in Pakistan. Aafia Siddiqui is an American-educated Pakistani neuroscientist who was sentenced in 2010 in a US federal court to 86 years in prison for trying to shoot some US personnel in Afghanistan. She was also an associate of Al-Qaeda, and she almost certainly played a role in at least one of its terrorist plots. Unfortunately, like many other suspected terrorists, she has never been put on trial for those acts. Obviously, these two are as different as they can be, and yet they also have several things in common, in addition to their conviction that the West and Islam are engaged in a colossal clash of civilizations. And one great similarity is that each woman has become a powerful symbol in the so-called war on terror. Each has become a kind of Joan of Arc figure to her admirers and a kind of demon figure to her enemies. Each is regarded by her own side as a savior and an emblem of courage, while being seen by others as bigoted, dangerous, and an enabler of violence. Let me talk tonight about three things, and I'll have to interweave them rather than taking them up one by one. First, I'd like to tell you how I came to tell these two women's stories. Second, I want to give you a quick sense of what I make of them after following them for almost 7 years. And third, I'd like to share just a few of the general lessons I feel I've learned from their cases about the war on terror. It all started for me when I was working as a newspaper reporter in the 1980s and the early 90s. I began spending time reporting on women in the Muslim world at a time when Islam was becoming more politicized and assertive. I kept noticing that the rise of political Islam always seemed to be accompanied by a struggle over the rights of Muslim women. Wherever Islamism took power, Islamism being the political ideology aimed at basing states on Islamic law, women always struck me as the first losers. And yet, curiously, women were also among the biggest supporters of Islamism. Such facts puzzle many Westerners, but they don't seem so startling to Muslims. In fact, and I'll say more about this later, many feminists in the Muslim world who bravely support women's rights also view themselves as observant Muslims and sometimes also as Islamists. There are also many different varieties of Islamists. The most extreme and fanatical are the violent jihadis or religious warriors who terrorize civilians. These ultra-Islamists include Al-Qaeda. After Al-Qaeda attacked the United States in 2001, I made up my mind to explore what their war against the West meant for women. It was a simple journalistic idea, and after a while I decided I should focus on two women. They would be Muslims who took very different paths, who chose opposite sides of a frightening divide. Let me read you from a passage in the book's introduction about how I ended up spending years investigating two women, polar opposites, who never met, the radical westernizer Ayaan Hirsi Ali and the American-educated Islamist Aafia Siddiqui. It began with a coincidence. On November 3rd, 2004, I was standing in line for a security check at the Atlanta airport when I read in the newspaper that the Dutch filmmaker Theo van Gogh had been murdered in Amsterdam. The article said that van Gogh had been bicycling to work when a younger, bearded man wearing traditional Arab clothes and a prayer cap cycled up next to him. Brandishing a pistol, the stranger fired 8 shots and then pulled 2 knives from his robe. With the larger knife, he nearly sawed off the filmmaker's head. With a smaller one, he penned a 5-page letter to Van Gogh's body. The letter was addressed to a Dutch Somali politician named Ayaan Hirsi Ali, who had collaborated with Van Gogh to produce a short film about how Islam mistreated women. In a kind of incantation, the murderer predicted that Ayaan Hirsi Ali would be destroyed, that the Netherlands would be destroyed, Europe would be destroyed, and finally, that the United States would fall before the might of Islam. The words made me shiver, and not just because such lurid crimes weren't supposed to happen in easygoing Amsterdam. The fate of Theo van Gogh, a great-great-grandnephew of the 19th century painter Vincent van Gogh, recalled the beheading 2 years earlier of Daniel Pearl, a reporter in Pakistan for the Wall Street Journal. The U.S. government had recently announced that Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, the super terrorist who was said to have planned the 9/11 attacks, had also murdered Pearl. I happened to be on my way just then to the very city where Pearl had been killed. My assignment for Vogue magazine was to discover more about a mysterious Pakistani woman named Aafia Siddiqui, whom the FBI accused of working for Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, or KSM, as books and newspapers often called him after the shorthand of the world's intelligence agencies. Aafia Siddiqui, by then, had become the most wanted woman in the world. Several months earlier, U.S. Attorney General John Ashcroft had named her as one of 7 suspected terrorists and the only woman who posed a, quote, clear and present danger to the United States. This Aafia Siddiqui was clearly a formidable woman. She had scientific degrees from MIT and Brandeis University. She was said to be one of the very few Al-Qaeda associates with the scientific expertise to help pull off a sophisticated attack. She and her ex-husband, a Pakistani anesthesiologist who'd practiced in Boston when the couple lived there, had made suspicious money transfers, according to the U.S. government. They had bought military equipment on the internet. Most ominously, Aafia Siddiqui was alleged to have helped KSM, the 9/11 mastermind, to further a terrifying plot to blow up a series of Baltimore's underground gas tanks. Aafia Siddiqui's friends and relatives disputed everything about the FBI's portrait of her. Her friends in Boston insisted that she was, quote, just a mom. Her family's American lawyer claimed that the family hadn't seen her since March 2003, when she climbed into a minicab in Karachi with her 3 young children. The lawyer said the family was desperately worried about all 4 of them. So I flew to Karachi to learn more about Aafia Siddiqui. In Pakistan and later in Boston, I found people who knew her well, including her former in-laws. I began to piece together a picture of who she had been before she vanished. I learned, for example, that in Boston, she had been a prominent student fundraiser for jihad, armed Muslim struggles in Bosnia and elsewhere. And I learned that the FBI believed that she had tried to help a Pakistani man who was working for KSM to enter the United States by opening a post office box for him in December 2001 in Maryland. By the end of these journeys in 2004, I still had no idea where Aafia Siddiqui was. But I no longer thought she might be just a mom who had been swept up in the war and terror by mistake. Soon after I returned to the US, I got another magazine assignment, this time focusing on Ayaan Hirsi Ali. I had heard of Ayaan Hirsi Ali mainly as a glamorous and courageous feminist critic of Islam's laws on women. But in Amsterdam, I learned that she was more controversial than that. She claimed that the West was in a war with Islam, not with Al-Qaeda or radical Islam, but Islam in general. She called the Prophet Muhammad a pervert and a tyrant. She said that Muslims should quit regarding him as their paragon of moral behavior. She wanted to shut down Holland's Muslim schools. She had even suggested that it might be necessary to deny Muslims the same civil liberties as Jews and Christians. I learned that Muslims and non-Muslims seem to hear Ayaan Hirsi Ali in two different registers. Non-Muslims seem to consider her a liberating breath of fresh air in the politically correct world of Dutch politics. Muslims, on the other hand, heard her less as a feminist than as a poorly informed critic of Islam and of Muslims. One Muslim feminist told me that Ayaan Hirsi Ali made her job as an activist in the Dutch Muslim community 10 times harder because Ayaan associated feminism with the hatred of Muslims. I need to backtrack briefly into history here. When Ayaan Hirsi Ali urged the West to liberate Muslim women, forcibly if necessary, she was walking into a debate with a long and fiery history. In the 19th century, European builders of empires, who seized power across the Muslim world, often justified their rule on the grounds that they were freeing Muslim women. Britain's Lord Cromer, for example, who in Britain was a founding member and sometime president of the Men's League for Opposing Women's Suffrage, wrote that Islam's degradation of women was the, quote, fatal obstacle that rendered Egyptian men inferior to Europeans. Muslim nationalists of the time pointed out the hypocrisy of these arguments, and Muslim conservatives, then as now, pointed to the link between feminism and imperialism as a way of discrediting the whole project of releasing Muslim women from Islam's traditions of veiling and seclusion. In short, while Ayaan Hirsi Ali's type of feminism was widely regarded in the West as heroic and useful, Muslim women often saw her as condescending and hostile. This old debate was one that the Pakistani Islamist Aafia Siddiqui knew very well, but from the other side. As a college student at MIT, Aafia had made a name for herself as a defender of Islam against the West. I had just finished writing my article about her, and I couldn't help comparing the two. Both women were then in their early 30s. They both came from the periphery of the Muslim world. Both had moved to the West, and at a turning point in history, the end of the Cold War. They both came from politically active families, and they were both fiercely intelligent. Like most educated Muslims of their generation, they had also both been strongly influenced by Islamism. The Pakistani Aafia Siddiqui knew of Islamism from her mother, a Muslim preacher and a social worker with close ties to fundamentalist clerics, generals, and politicians. As for the Somali Ayaan Hirsi Ali, she had once fallen under the spell of a local Muslim Brotherhood group when she was a teenage refugee growing up in Kenya. And both women saw Islamism and Islam as essentially the same. This is a really important point. The real core of Islam, they believed, was the conquering, fundamentalist, political interpretation of it. And all those less politicized and more conventional Muslims, who include most of the world's Muslim population of 1.5 billion people, were, in their view, ignorant of the true essence of their faith. But then, of course, their reactions diverged. The Islamist, Aafia Siddiqui, embraced the notion of fundamentalist Islam, while the passionate Westernizer, Ayaan Hirsi Ali, eventually came to hate and fear it. Both women, I should add, were also strongly influenced by Western feminism. Here in the Netherlands, Ayaan Hirsi Ali came to see herself as a feminist. Aafia Siddiqui, on the other hand, although she studied feminism in the US and claimed a place for herself in the competitive world of science, ultimately told the FBI that she rejected Western feminism as a blind alley for women. In any case, they became heroines to opposing sides in the war on terror. And it seemed to me that if I could follow their two stories, I might shed some light on the whole conflict. For me, the question was how two intelligent women exposed to many of the same intellectual influences and historical events could have turned out so differently. It certainly was no coincidence that they did. Each woman chose the path that she was on. But as I dug into their backgrounds, I learned that one great difference between them was the way in which they related to their families and their cultures. Aafia Siddiqui came from Pakistan to a series of U.S. universities with the full support of her religiously conservative family. The Somali-born Ayaan Hirsi Ali, by contrast, got a university education on her own initiative after running away from an arranged marriage and seeking asylum in the Netherlands. She rebelled, in other words. Her relationship with her family was difficult and painful, and no doubt that made it easier for her when she gave up her faith. Aafia Siddiqui's obedience to her doting Pakistani family extended to her marriage, which her parents arranged. The marriage wasn't a happy one, but she bore three children with the Pakistani doctor and did so while pursuing her scientific education. Later, her achievements burnished her image in Pakistan as a, quote, daughter of the nation, who remained loyal to her family and culture despite the blandishments of the West. Then came 9/11. Both women by then were marked by the beliefs and commitments that later made them famous. But 9/11 seemed to tip them over the edge. Let me read a passage from my book about their reactions. Ayaan Hirsi Ali was in Amsterdam when it happened. Ayaan was obsessed with the 9/11 attacks. She kept thinking about the lead hijacker, Mohammed Atta, and his cold, dead eyes. She and the Egyptian were about the same age, and they both arrived in Europe in the summer of 1992. I felt that I knew him, she wrote, and in fact, I did know many people like him. Later, she wrote that she identified with Atta's rage. She felt that she understood the hostility and the hatred he felt toward himself and others. She watched a television interview with Atta's father. The man was angry and despairing. He refused to believe that his son could have committed the attacks. When he insisted that the Jews or the CIA must have done it, Ayaan knew that Atta must have been taught the same hateful version of Islam that she had been taught. Did the 9/11 attacks stem from true belief in true Islam, she asked herself. The little shutter at the back of her brain opened and her thoughts came tumbling out. She remembered what she had learned about love and hate for Allah from her teacher, Sister Aziza, and the preacher, Bokul Swam, in Nairobi. She had believed everything Atta had believed, only she hadn't been given the chance to do anything about it. This was not Islam, she decided. This was the core of Islam. She felt enormous fear. She read bin Laden's statements. She looked at Atta's will. She heard the note of the Islam she had grown up with. Every devout Muslim who aspired to practice genuine Islam, the Muslim Brotherhood Islam, the Islam of the Medina Quran schools, even if they didn't actively support the attacks, they must have at least approved of them. She asked herself questions. Was innovation forbidden to Muslims? Were human rights, progress, women's rights all foreign to Islam? The dissonance became excruciating. I realized that I could either go mad, join the bin Ladenist, or step out of the religion, she later wrote. Aafia Siddiqui had already made her decision. See you in paradise, she told her girlfriends in Boston as she left for Karachi on September 17th. As far as Aafia was concerned, the clash of civilizations had begun. Of course, they both believed in a fateful clash of civilizations. So did Al-Qaeda and large numbers of Islamist sympathizers, and so, in fact, did several key advisors to the Bush administration. Aafia Siddiqui, who fled from Boston to Pakistan after 9/11, tried to convince her husband to join the Taliban or another jihadi group with her. But he refused, and he later divorced her. Then something absolutely extraordinary happened. Intent on getting closer to the center of jihad, Aafia Siddiqui met and apparently fell in love with the 26-year-old nephew of KSM, the mastermind of 9/11. The young man's name was Ali Abdul Aziz Ali, and he was already very much in the family business of jihadi terrorism. Aafia Siddiqui agreed to go on a mission for him. She flew to the U.S. and opened that post office box for another Pakistani Al-Qaeda operative who was trying to re-enter the U.S. All he needed was an American mailing address to get his immigration documents. But when KSM was arrested in March 2003, the operative, whose name was Majid Khan, was also arrested, and the FBI soon listed Aafia Siddiqui as wanted for questioning. That's when Aafia Siddiqui and her three children left her mother's house and disappeared. She didn't surface again for 5 years. 9/11 also dramatically changed the life of Ayaan Hirsi Ali. She began writing and speaking out about how Islam, not extreme Islam, but Islam as a whole, was living in the Dark Ages and needed an enlightenment. In 2002, she began receiving death threats. The Dutch public was outraged to learn that this well-spoken young Muslim woman was being threatened for saying out loud about Islam what many Dutch people believed in private. And the Liberal Party offered her the chance to stand for parliament. If she won, this job would also provide her with government-paid bodyguards. And so she ran for parliament and was elected in 2003 by a wide margin. And so, just as Aafia Siddiqui was disappearing, Ayaan Hirsi Ali was entering the spotlight. But eventually, both women would enjoy the spotlight as heroines. And they both owed their fame to their enemies. Ayaan Hirsi Ali's case is widely known. After becoming famous in the Netherlands for the death threats against her, she became celebrated around the world when a would-be jihadist murdered her film collaborator, Theo van Gogh. She became the symbol of everything that many Westerners feared was threatened by Islam: free speech, equal rights for women, a culture, as you say here in Holland, of anything goes. Even those who disagreed with her sweeping denunciations of Islam and of Muslims felt that they had to back her rather than seem to give in to her jihadist enemies. Aafia Siddiqui became a Joan of Arc figure in Pakistan because she too seemed to be the victim of a culture's mortal enemy. But the enemy in her case was the United States. The FBI and the CIA were hunting her, unjustly, many Pakistanis assumed. How could this respectable young scientist and mother be connected with terrorists? Moreover, since the CIA was known to be kidnapping Al-Qaeda suspects and holding them in secret prisons, Pakistanis were primed to believe that the U.S. and Pakistani governments were simply lying when they said they didn't know where Aafia Siddiqui was. In truth, Aafia later told the FBI that when she left her mother's house, she went to stay with the family of Ali Abdul Aziz Ali, and that she married him there. She also said that she spent the years after Ali's 2003 arrest on the run. But millions of Pakistanis, as well as untold numbers of other Muslims, assumed that her confession was coerced, probably by torture. They believe that the Pakistani government handed her over to the U.S. in exchange for money in 2003, and they believe that her capture in Afghanistan in 2008 was a setup. Her later trial in New York on the narrow charge of picking up a loose rifle and firing it at U.S. soldiers and investigators is widely regarded in Pakistan as a sham. And to this day, her supporters hold demonstrations calling upon the Pakistani government to somehow bring her back from the U.S. Even those Pakistanis who are troubled by her links with Al-Qaeda often feel obliged to support her cause as a way of protesting the CIA and the Pakistani government's policy of killing and kidnapping people without charge. I told you earlier that I hoped these two women's stories would shed some light on the war on terror. Did they? They did, for me anyway. Armed conflicts are notorious for their blinding passions. And my pursuit of these two women has been an education in multiple blindnesses and tragic passions. Both women became quite dualistic in their thinking, good and evil, black and white, us versus them. And many of their most passionate supporters still are. It's the stuff of war. 10 years into the so-called war on terror, a conflict that has cost more than 100,000 lives, Each side still has its own narrative, its own catalog of deadly complaints. Heroines are useful in such a world. They serve as symbols of victimization and virtuous aggression. In Pakistan, despite her trial, Aafia Siddiqui is still regarded as innocent. I wish US prosecutors had tried her on charges of terrorism and told the world the evidence they have against her. Instead, deep secrecy still afflicts our struggle with Al-Qaeda, not to mention our battered legal process. As for Ayaan Hirsi Ali, you'll need to read my book to get my full account, but it's safe to say I find her more complicated and needlessly divisive than the unvarnished heroine that many Westerners make her out to be. But I also find her more attractive and sympathetic than the crude fraud and sellout that some of her critics have made her out to be. One is a would-be terrorist, the other is an author and activist, so they aren't morally equivalent by any stretch of imagination. Yet both women have made extreme, misinformed, and highly provocative statements about their chosen enemies. And their defenders have sometimes responded in ways that can best be described as hysterical and propagandistic. Which raises another finding. These widespread passions have sometimes been used in totally cynical ways. The alleged persecution of Aafia Siddiqui has been used to further a bloodthirsty Islamist agenda. Ayaan Hirsi Ali has been used in the West to further an aggressive agenda against the Muslim world. Indeed, the whole subject of women's rights has been used as a kind of weapon in the larger war on terror. Right-wing political groups here and in the US have used Ayaan Hirsi Ali's message about Islam's oppression of women to help drum up support for Western military action against Iraq and Iran, and as a way of criticizing liberals whom they regard as soft on Muslims. And right-wing groups in Pakistan have used Aafia Siddiqui's imprisonment, stories true and false, to drum up public sentiment favoring Islamist parties and against a Pakistani government they say kowtows to Washington. In both cases, what has been drowned out are the voices of thousands of Muslim women who, unlike Ayaan Hirsi Ali and Aafia Siddiqui, continue to work for positive changes from within their own Muslim communities, sometimes at risk of their own lives. These women, like the Nobel Peace Prize winner Shireen Ebadi, say that women do not need to make a choice between Islam and democracy. Instead, they are working to interpret Islam in a way that's compatible with modern ideas of democracy and human rights. Let me finish up with one last point that I think illustrates the way opposites like Aafia Siddiqui and Ayaan Hirsi Ali sometimes seem to work together even though they have never met and couldn't be more different. Because despite their living worlds apart, I learned of one indirect link between them, a kind of a 6 degrees of separation. As I read to you earlier, the savage method of Theo van Gogh's murder recalled the earlier beheading of Daniel Pearl in Karachi. Moreover, after van Gogh's murder, Dutch investigators discovered that his killer, Mohamed Bouyeri, had prepared himself to murder van Gogh by obsessively watching the horrifying murder video that Daniel Pearl's killers had made. That awful film, by the way, had a title, The Slaughter of the Spy Journalist, the Jew, Daniel Pearl. But who exactly filmed Daniel Pearl's murder? The public only learned the answer last year. That's when independent investigators with a group called the Pearl Project at Georgetown University released their report on the crime. The report showed that the man who filmed KSM personally cutting Pearl's throat was none other than KSM's young nephew, Ali Abdul Aziz Ali, the same man who later married Aafia Siddiqui. As I wrote in the book, it was just a horrible coincidence, but what struck me was the impact, almost like a butterfly effect, that Ali's film had on Ayaan Hirsi Ali's rise to stardom as an Islam critic. For it was the slaughter of the spy journalist, the Jew Daniel Pearl, and the many copycat versions that followed it that had inspired Mohamed Bouyeri and taught him how to murder Theo van Gogh. and it was Boyeri's murder of Van Gogh that made Ayaan and her film Submission internationally famous. Not for the first time, it seemed to me that the opposite ends of the spectrum in the so-called war on terror had unconsciously come together to aggravate the clash of civilizations that they both insist is unavoidable. Thank you all for being here.
Would you care for some water?
Yes, please. Thank you, Mara.
Letting our guest speaker getting her breath back after an amazing story of two strong women. While I was listening to you, I thought of another strong woman from the Arab world who is also closely connected to an Islamic party in Yemen, Tawakkul Karman.
Yes.
She won the Nobel Prize for Peace.
Right.
Well, she shared it with two Liberian women, but she basically was seen as the voice of the Arab Spring.
That's right.
The female voice of the Arab Spring. Now, what do you think Aafia and Ayaan, I mean, it's speculating, I know, but, you know, having studied both women, how would they see this prize? Because in a way, it defeats both of their ideologies, I would say.
Yeah. Well, you know, Ayaan has written about the Arab Spring, and she's a little bit suspicious that really it's leading to an Islamist winter, that, you know, what we have looked at as a rise of democracy is really going to be an opening for Islamists. So I think she would see the awarding of the prize as a sort of another naive Western wishful thinking. Aafia, I suspect she would admire the woman and the women who have been active in the Arab Spring. But of course, for her, the important thing is that Islam should triumph. And she sees the conflict as the West, with the West as, you know, the essential conflict. So,
A friend of mine in Egypt, he said, in a way, of course, we all know who killed Osama bin Laden, but he said, in a symbolic way, Mohammed Bouazizi, the grocery man in Sidi Bouzid, killed the ideology. And for me, it was remarkable to see during those demonstrations that there weren't many banners with Osama bin Laden.
Yeah.
Anyway, a friend of mine who is a VVD, a member of parliament, Anton Broeken, always says, he always says we should be careful not to do the Vivaldization of the Arab revolutions. And I think he's right. It's too easy to put seasons to a complicated transformation process.
Right.
Although the Four Seasons are still beautiful music. In your book, you talk about macho religiosity and macho liberalism. And I would like you to expand a little bit about the role of men in the lives of these two women. They're close family members, their husbands, or their alleged husbands, or the husbands they were supposed to be married to, either forcibly or out of choice. You go into this. So you have the macho religiosity and the macho liberalism. And how have these men in the lives of Ayaan and Aafia used their passion for their own purposes? Or abused,
how
in a way.
How they used the men. Both Aafia and Ayaan, especially Ayaan, was able to use the men in her life to achieve her own goals. But macho religiosity is a term I talked about Aafia Siddiqui and how the macho religiosity of Al-Qaeda, of the jihadist groups that she was involved with when she was a student fundraiser, raising money. And what she used to do was to get up in front of audiences, especially of men, and she was the only woman who would raise money for these causes. And she would say, "Why do I have to be up here?" In other words, a woman shouldn't have to be doing this, but I'm having to step out of my role as a woman because of the great dangers facing Islam. And if you men were doing your job, I wouldn't need to be doing this.
And she could be the mom.
And she could, yes.
Okay. Did she really mean that?
I think she loved it. You know, she enjoyed doing it. I don't think she really wanted to take a backseat at
Stay
all.
Stay home mom.
No, not at all. In fact, one of the things that I talked about in the book is that the former head of part of the CIA who had been looking after her said that they kept hoping, and they probably were right, that she would just drive the members of Al-Qaeda so crazy that they would never be able to use her as an effective operative because they just couldn't take a woman who was so bossy. Mm-hmm. And that may have been exactly what happened. And Ayaan, on the other hand, you know, she grew up admiring her father, who was a politician, mm-hmm. and he was really her role model. She wanted to be like him. And she often says, even though her political ideology is completely opposite of his, she feels that she is like him because she has become a political leader. And she had various male mentors here in the Netherlands and now in the United States, but she's always been able to, she's never had to go behind them. She's always been able to sort of leapfrog over them to the next step. So.
But in a way, the way you describe them, both of them are kind of queen bees as well.
That's true.
Because there are there are not real, you didn't go into the, well, there are not many women around them. Yeah, mothers and sisters, but not ideological, you know, role models for them.
No, that's true. They both kind of gravitated to other men in their political careers. They sought out men and they were lifted up by men as well.
Just staying for one more question with the man on International Women's Day. I was struck by the first marriage and the way also you describe it, that her first husband, he seemed of Aafia.
Aafia, yeah.
Who, her husband seemed like a pretty normal guy who wanted to be a doctor in the States and make a career, and his parents in Pakistan were pushing him and very, very proud. And there, in this arranged marriage, it was an arranged marriage.
Yes.
He finds this feisty, I mean, I'm not seeing that as a compliment. Huh? I mean, of course, I disagree with what she stands for, just for the audience to know, because we don't want to be speaking in admiring terms of Aafia in a way you have been accused of in some of the reviews. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know that you don't want to do this, but this guy seemed to like her, and she liked him in a way.
At the beginning. Yeah.
So what can you tell us about this marriage? What went wrong?
Well, it's interesting because Aafia came from this religiously conservative family, and her mother was a sort of a preacher, and one of the first women Islamist preachers in Pakistan. And Aafia sort of took that, and she became a preacher herself while she was a student in the United States. But then when she got ready to graduate, several other men who were interested in jihad, fellow students, wanted to marry her and wrote to her parents asking for her hand. And that would have allowed Aafia to do what she really wanted, which was to go to Bosnia and join a jihad and be on the battleground. But her parents were not that radical. They wanted her to marry a nice doctor. And so they found this perfect proposal by this young man who was the top of his class, and he was coming to Boston already to be a doctor, and they thought it would be just perfect. And it wasn't what Aafia really wanted, but she agreed to go along with it because she revered her parents, and Islam says that you should obey your parents. So, and first it seemed to go okay, but then Aafia, she, despite saying that she wanted to comply with Islam and everything, she right away took the position that the rule that says a wife needs to obey a husband is superseded by the rule saying that you have an obligation to support jihad. And so her husband, who just wanted to be a doctor, she kept trying to drag him into her different Islamist activities, and they had more and more clashes, and eventually they split up over her efforts. And she would argue to him, you know, you're wrong, you know, you don't understand Islam, this is your responsibility. And he couldn't get her to believe that it was her duty to obey him, because she didn't think he knew as much about Islam as she did.
There he was, this nice doctor. I enjoyed reading the part about Ayaan's efforts to be at the deathbed of her father.
Uh-huh.
It's a very touching part of the book, a part I wasn't really aware of. I mean, I've followed her story here in the Netherlands and going to the States, and I think I wondered, and I don't want to be an amateur psychologist, but all of a sudden when I was reading it, it dawned on me, her father was absent for most of her life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, is it too easy to say, I mean, like Madonna's song, that she was looking for a father figure, or...
Well, I wouldn't want to psychoanalyze Ayaan. But she writes about that scene in Nomad, her mm-hmm. last book, and how she was able to reach his deathbed just before he died, and she did find some closure because of that. And then after that happened, she then was able to get in touch with her mother mm-hmm. for the first time in many years. So she did sort of reconnect with her family on account of that.
Speaking about her second book, Ayaan's second book, Nomad, in my mind, it's worth reading, if only for one page. Yeah. I mean, I enjoyed reading the book. Again, it upset me and lots of things. But there's one page where I think she describes very sharply what happened to her in the Dutch society. Mm-hmm. And it's the whole concept of how the Dutch society is actually a very close society, and you have this insider group, the 200 to 300 people who are the establishment, and she was adopted by this mm-hmm. group. She describes mm-hmm. it in the book. Mm-hmm. And how, while she was adopted and played along the rules of the group, she was the heroine of the group. Mm-hmm. In a way, almost as the nice marriage with the doctor, the insider group in the Netherlands did not see clearly mm-hmm. what was waiting for them.
Right.
Because, in a way, she is not a conformist. She is a very autonomous, independent person, and she did not want to play along the rules, I felt.
Absolutely. She didn't. She
so
certainly
this insider-outsider, yeah. How has that played in her... In the recent years, because in going to the States, again, that's a new group.
Right. Well, I think Ayaan is just an absolutely fascinating character. I mean, just as a person, as a woman, she's extraordinary. And, you know, obviously that group, the, you know, elite, the Dutch elite, they were welcoming her into their inner circle, and they thought that she would be so pleased to be in that circle that she would go along with the customs, as she later compared it to belonging to the clan. She said they have all the same norms and customs. And she...
On sword
it's
minster,
interesting
huh?
because yeah. she said, you know, she said it's like being the clan, and she, just as she wasn't about to go along with the clan, she understood the rules very well. She simply decided she wasn't going to abide by that. It was the same thing here in the Netherlands. She made up her own rules, and when they tried to call her on it, she wouldn't have it, and she found an escape for herself going to the United States.
Yeah, but tell us, I mean, the American Enterprise Institute and, well, conservative Americans, they're a clan as well, aren't they?
Absolutely, and she does seem to feel there that, well, I mean, maybe it's just that she's found her place and she just feels very comfortable with them. But it seems to be one place where she is more willing to go along with the rules. I mean, she very seldom criticizes the Republican orthodoxy nowadays, unlike she did here. Yeah.
Before we go to the audience, I have one last question about how both women deal with other voices from their own groups. Mm-hmm. You write about it, how Ayaan has never really written about the liberal voices within Islam. Well, she dismisses mm-hmm. that they can exist. But right. people like Nasser Hamed Abu Zaid, an Egyptian scholar who found refuge in the Netherlands, mm-hmm. of course, he's also disliked in the mm-hmm. Arab world by many Muslims, mm-hmm. we have to say that. But he has a very liberal way at looking at how to interpret mm-hmm. the Quran. Or right. Abdullah Naim, a Sudanese right. Scholar of human rights and yes. Islam. And Aafia as well, I mean... There are so many people in Pakistan who don't agree with her.
Uh-huh.
So how do they, both women, have dealt in their lives with dissenting voices within their own groups?
Well, Ayaan's position on those liberal Muslims, and she's written about it, is that she simply feels they don't have any power. So she'll say, you know, Westerners make a big deal about these people, but they're really a small group of people, and they're not very influential. And what we need to be looking at are the Islamists, who are really the up-and-coming power. So that's her position. That's how she would dismiss that argument, I think. But Aafia, I mean, she looked at liberal Muslims as people who were on the road to hell. And she used to stop them, you know, at her university she attended, you know, and try to talk. She was a missionary, you know, and try to talk them into wearing the headscarf and praying and fasting. And I mean, one young woman who went to school with Aafia, went to university with her, said to me she was a maniac. She drove people crazy. So she was more of a proselytizer. Mm-hmm. She was aware that they were there. She wanted to change them.
I would like to go to the audience and let's have a conversation. Let's have a conversation. Can I invite you to come to the microphone? Is that how it works, Russell? Or is there somebody walking around with the microphone? Good evening.
Well, thank you for giving me the floor. And thank you. My name is Fritz Bolkestein. Deborah Scroggins may remember me. We had lunch in Amsterdam just before you returned to the States. But your book was by then already finished.
No.
Anyway, I want to thank you for writing this book. I want to thank you for writing this book, in particular for the parts on Pakistan and on Aafia. I knew that the Deobandi were the Pakistani form of Salafists, but I didn't know they were that powerful. And I'm grateful to you for pointing that out in your book to people like myself. My criticism of your book pertains to the parts on Ayaan, a person I have known well. We were tipped off, if you like, by the press statement by the John Adams Institute, which said, Ayaan is lauded in America as a champion of the cause of women within Islam, but the Dutch know her differently. She stirred sharp feelings here. I take this to mean that we do not agree with the part of this introduction that she championed the cause of women in Islam, and I think this is incorrect. But it is a pointer in the direction of your book. Now, obviously, you did not write this introductory comment in the published statement of the Adams Institute. So it's not your doing. It's the Institute itself that did so. Now, you write at the end of your book. And you repeated that just now. Aafia and Ayaan are not equivalent figures, morally or otherwise. And you explain by saying Ayaan fights only with words and concepts. Aafia helped terrorists. That is perfectly true. Unfortunately, the book itself does not really corroborate this statement of non-equivalence. Because the way I read your book, I find your portrayal, your portrait of Ayaan, tendentious and predisposed against her. In that, I'm not alone. You will remember the New York Times review of your book, where the writer said that you accused Ayaan of being imperious, deceitful, egomaniacal, divisive, and whipping up racial hatred through her unsubtle criticism of Islam. Now, these are harsh words. No doubt you have taken cognizance of them. Having read the book, I must agree. I find that a valid criticism, and it is unfortunate and a great pity. You say they were not equivalent, and we all agree, I think. But you do also write, they were mirror images. And in the end of your talk, you say they were opposite, which joined themselves, which joined in the end. You say they were mirror images, and you quoted, you said, and you wrote that Breivik...
I'm going to be strict with everybody, sure? Out of respect, I'm
just about finished. You said that Breivik wanted to give her the Nobel Prize for Peace. Mm-hmm. You associate Ayaan with Breivik in the same way that the Dutch historian Geert Mak associated her film, Submission, with Die Ewige Jude, a film authorized by Goebbels. Mm-hmm. I think that is... that is very tendentious. Mm-hmm. It reminds me of Senator McCarthy's use of the tactics of guilt by association. Okay. So I think that you withdraw that.
I think, Mr. Wolkenstein, you
I
made
now come
character.
To the question.
Okay.
Because
actually, I've said a rule before, and I'm going to say it now. Before you, everybody who thinks that they missed something in the book, well, you've read it, so you don't have to buy it anymore.
Have.
But maybe you can give it as a present. But let's keep our questions and introductions brief. Please,
the
your
question is the following. You write, the West used Islamic attitudes for women, or to women, so as to, I quote, justify the West's continued domination of Muslim men. The West's continued domination of Muslim men. Mm-hmm. Most Muslims live in Asia. Mm-hmm. 200 million of them live in Indonesia, which is a country I know well, Bangladesh, Pakistan. Does the West dominate all those men? Are you referring to the war against Iraq, which I've always opposed? Mm-hmm. What did you mean by this continued domination of Muslim men by the West? It is incomprehensible.
Okay.
That was my question.
Well, a starter.
Thank you very much.
There are a few
points there. Where to start.
Somebody doesn't like your book. And
well, you sort of made yourself clear. Thank you for coming. Well,
for me, it would be an enticement to actually buy the book and read it, your criticism. So,
I probably should have been taking notes. You made so many different points. But, let's start out with, I'd just like to make a point about that New York Times review. The quote that you actually listed, the phrases used, imperious, deceitful, and so on, I really took offense at that because those were his words, not mine. There's not one, I've never called Ayaan imperious, I've never called her deceitful. That's his interpretation of the book, and those were his words. So that's his thinking, not mine. What other things? I mean, I feel like it's more of a statement than a question. The question that you raise at the end, why do I say that the message of oppression of the oppression of women in Islam is used to justify the domination of Muslim men
by the West.
By the West, yes. Well, I think that, and I think it's been done here in the Netherlands, as I said in my statement. I think that it's been used to further an aggressive agenda. And I was specifically thinking of the invasion of Iraq, also the Ayaan's encouragement of a strike against Iran. I think that people use the idea that the Islam oppresses women as an excuse, and it's historical, not just now, but in the past, as I mentioned Lord Cromer, as an excuse for the domination of Islam by the West. And when I say it's by men, it's because men are the ones who are in control in those countries. So that's what I meant by that.
Well, I have a reading tip. One of the books I love to read about specifically this topic is by Derek Hopwood. It's about sexual relations between the West and the Middle East, and it's about the 19th century, as you were talking about as well, the French and British adventures in the Middle East and the penetration of the Middle East to civilize and rescue these women. And some of the, because I looked into it, and some of the speeches of the authors of the 19th century, it seems that the speechwriters of George Bush, George W. Bush, have used those texts as a basis for their speeches on the invasion of Iraq. So I can, it's an interesting book, Sexual Relations Between the West and the Middle East, Derek Hopwood, Oxford University. More questions. Don't be shy, and maybe thank you for a very long introduction, but maybe the rest can keep it a bit briefer. Sir. Oh, there's somebody sitting behind you. Please, could you come to the microphone?
I'm Tom Milo, good friend of Deborah. I'm intrigued by the by this approach that we now see an attempt to get a face on anonymous phenomena. But Ayaan Hirsi Ali is of course well known. You try to work in symmetries. Here you see a kind of polarity that Ayaan is very well known, at least here, and Aafia is not known at all. And it's very interesting to see how the personal relations behind this perceived war on terror or war by terror is actually can be boiled down to a relatively small number of individuals that apparently seem to be able to pull a lot of strings. And I just wonder what's your take on this?
Well, one of the interesting things about the book, one of the things that became clear as I was working on the book, is what a small group of people who were actually involved with Al-Qaeda, you know, how Aafia really got to the center of it and knew some of the most important people, and it really was such a small group of people, which was not something, you know, immediately after 9/11, we weren't really sure what Al-Qaeda was, and sometimes it seemed to be an amorphous, enormous thing. And I think looking at Aafia's story showed me that it was actually much smaller than we feared.
With an enormous following.
The
daughter of the nation?
Daughter of the nation. Well, yeah. That's what Aafia is called in Pakistan, mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. But that's by millions of Pakistanis. They're not involved with Al-Qaeda.
Because when you Google her name on Dutch websites, there are lots of people in the Netherlands with Muslim backgrounds on Muslim sites who see her as a sister who needs to be rescued from the...
But they generally see her as innocent. They'll claim that she's completely innocent. They don't believe that she worked for Al-Qaeda. And one of the reasons they don't believe that is because it hasn't been reported in the Pakistani press. All that's reported is that she's a victim and she's, you know, there are all these conspiracy theories and so on.
Because she is in jail now. She has been
sentenced
for
86 years in U.S. prison.
More questions. I see men only raising their hands. That can't be true on International
Women's Day.
While we were talking about two women. So, please. Very charming.
Sorry,
man.
I'm a man. Dick Kraai. My question is about Ayaan Hirsi Ali. Uh-huh. Today, she is associated with a conservative institution. And before that, she was a member of parliament for the Liberal Party in the Netherlands, the Conservative Liberal Party. You did. I haven't read the book yet, but you didn't mention that she started a career, political career, with the Labour Party,
right,
who is today divided on Islam. Uh-huh. More and more. How would you comment on that? Ayaan Hirsi Ali is not really a conservative. She is. I don't see her as a right-wing person. Did you investigate on that? Did you focus on that in your book?
Well, I didn't focus on it specifically. I certainly did report that she had been a researcher for the Labour Party think tank when she first started speaking out about Islam. And then, of course, the Liberal Party invited her to stand for Parliament, and she switched at that point. As to whether she's really a conservative, you know, in the U.S., like I said, she certainly hasn't taken a stand against the Republican Party on anything that I can think of. But that's not really what she writes and speaks about. She doesn't speak about, for example, domestic issues. She really speaks about Islam, and you know what seems to be more important to her is the position that these parties take on Islam and the Muslim world rather than domestic policy. And you know, when she was here in the Netherlands, she still had a number of friends and followers within the Labour Party even after she joined the Liberal Party. So,
okay, there's a woman over there. I'm going to be, you know, equal. Please.
It's a it's a very small question. I was wondering what you know, if you know anything about Afia's children, where they are, what are they doing?
Yes,
where
so
they're living?
Aafia has three children, and they all disappeared with her when she disappeared in 2003. Her ex-husband believes, and he's the father of these three children, that, and also the FBI says that she spent those years in hiding, probably with the children. And her ex-husband believes that her extended family helped her and keep her, you know, helped hide her. So that's kind of what I think is probably the most likely thing that happened. But she was actually captured with her eldest son, and then he was later returned to her parents, her mother, her father's dead. And then her daughter, who was supposed to be missing, and, you know, again, the Pakistani press speculated feverishly that the children were in a secret prison somewhere. The daughter returned after Aafia was sentenced. The daughter just appeared on the mother's doorstep with a placard around her neck that with the address, her mother's address. Her mother said she didn't recognize the girl, but she was going to adopt the girl immediately. And then the third child, the youngest child, has never been returned. But again, the ex-husband believes that the family is, that he's living with the extended family under an assumed name. Whether that's true, I don't know, but that's... that's his belief.
But you believe the version that she disappeared and that she was in hiding. You don't believe the story that she was the unknown prisoner, 650.
Absolutely not.
And
no, I don't
why
believe
not?
That.
Maybe you should tell a little bit more about this, because that gives her, I think, a heroine status. That's
it certainly does. Well, after she disappeared, you know, there was a lot of speculation about where she was during her so-called missing years from 2003 to 2008. And many people speculated that she was in a secret prison, but because, of course, many al-Qaeda suspects were. And although the U.S. government and the Pakistani government said that they didn't know where she was, they also said that about Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, and everybody knew that he was in a secret prison. So Pakistanis, many people, including many human rights groups, wrote speculating that maybe Aafia was in a secret prison. But after she was captured in 2008, she confessed to the FBI that she had been on the run during those years. And there were also, you know, in the book I describe all the evidence, but there were also several different sightings of her in places throughout Pakistan that, to me, are evidence that she was actually in hiding during that time.
More questions? I see a few questions in the back. Can you come forward, please?
My name is April Umar. I was wondering what efforts did you make to talk to Ayaan, to interview her?
Well, I tried to interview her. I first wrote a magazine article about her, and I was in touch with her press person at the time, and we sort of had kind of email contact for that article. And then after that, I sent her my book proposal and wrote her several letters to her agent or via her agent. And she never responded to any of that. But later I got word through her agent that she was not interested in an interview and she was not interested in cooperating with me at all. And that's certainly her right.
One follow-up question?
I was wondering why. Do you have any idea why she wouldn't talk to you?
No, she never told me. So I don't really know.
More questions. I'm going from the back to the front. I think we have about 15 more minutes. The gentleman in the front has, over here.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Tom Lansner. I did read the book, and I'm part of it. Of course, the controversy seems to be over your discussion of Ayaan, but I found much more interesting, actually, the reporting on Aafia. And you described that you flew out to Pakistan after the murder of Daniel Pearl, and you were going around Karachi basically looking for al-Qaeda. I'd be very interested to hear about how that felt to you and about your own safety and how you found working in Pakistan under a very difficult situation as a journalist.
Thank you. Well, I talk in the book about how it was kind of a strange experience because that first time I went to Pakistan, I met a guy called Khalid Hawaja, who was a former Pakistani intelligence officer, and he had also been Osama bin Laden's former pilot. And he was implicated in the Daniel Pearl murder because he had been a person that Daniel Pearl had approached when he was trying to get the interview that ultimately led to his death. But this man, Khalid Hawaja, had become, just as he was in Pearl's time, he was kind of a conduit for journalists who were looking to meet jihadis. So I went to him to ask if he had any suggestions of how I could find out more about Aafia. And he really tried to steer me away. And he kept referring to the Daniel Pearl murder. And he said, you know, basically, if you keep poking into this story, you're going to end up like Daniel Pearl. But he was smiling when he said it. And he, you know, and there were other people in the room and they were all smiling. And I couldn't really tell whether he was serious or whether he was just sort of teasing me in a way. And so I just went ahead with my reporting, and fortunately nothing happened. But I have to admit that I did have some nervous moments. But anyway, fortunately it all turned out to be fine.
When you came to Pakistan, you didn't stay at the Marriott.
Well, no, I didn't.
You stayed with friends?
Right. As it became, when I first started in 2004, then later it was becoming so much more dangerous for Westerners. Every year it was becoming more dangerous. And then the second time when I came, after Aafia had been captured, I went again to see Khalid Hawaja, and he said, you know, I really was trying to scare you that time. I just wanted you to stay away from Aafia because I thought...
Why do you think her in-laws and her ex-husband were so forthcoming talking about her?
Well, the reason they were forthcoming is because they really wanted to find out where the children were. Her ex-husband, you know, still to this day has not been able to... He's been able to see the son once, but he's lost all contact with his children, basically. So when Aafia was missing, and then later after she was captured, they were just seeking a way to get back in touch with the children.
So they used you as their private detective, in a way?
They were just willing to talk to anybody who was looking for Aafia, and then later they wanted to get their side of the story out so that they could get access to the children again.
Okay. The lady over there? Yes.
So Aafia and Ayaan are obviously byproducts, as you've explained, about the whole... the divisions in Islam right now. If you cast your net a little further, are there other wanted women in other cultures we should be reading about, writing about?
Well, I'm sure there are. I'm sure there are, but I, you know, and I'm sure there are, but I chose that title, Wanted Women, because Aafia was, at the time, literally wanted, by the FBI. And, of course, Ayaan was wanted by the jihadis. So I thought that they were, that's why I chose that title. I don't know of any specific case that's similar in other cultures, but I'm sure there probably are.
Well, there are quite a number of wanted women at this moment who are coordinating the demonstrations in Damascus, and can tell you. I mean, if they put their head out, they will be killed, not because of their religious beliefs, but because they want to get rid of the dictator. I mean, that could be a good book. I can give you some names.
Yeah.
Over there, the gentleman. Yes. Yes, sir.
Ms. Scroggins, thank you very much. That was very interesting. My name is Saad Shah. I'm from Karachi. I hope you liked it. I'd like you to elaborate perhaps on the geopolitical role that the United States has in playing in actively suppressing the rights of women in Pakistan. You mentioned the 1980s when extremism was rising in the world. That was incidentally also the time when Pakistan had the most vicious, the most venal dictator ever in our history, a man who introduced some of the most vicious laws against women, the Hudud Ordinance, the stoning, and so on and so forth. Nonetheless, the United States poured in billions of dollars to him, even despite the fact that Pakistanis, are, in my opinion, are inherently liberal, and you don't have to believe me. I mean, you just have to look at the fact that, I mean, maybe you can tell me how much percentage of votes do religious parties in Pakistan get today? Do you know the figure?
I don't know the figure, but I know it's a small number.
It's 3%. Uh-huh. 3% of people are in their right minds to vote for extremism. The rest of the people vote for secular parties, and of course it's not perfect. We have a long way to go. We have immense forces that are pitted against the liberal parts of Pakistan that we're fighting against. But, I mean, as an American yourself, could you perhaps please elaborate on how the United States stokes and fans the flames of not only extremism, but eventually undermines the rights of women as an extension also? Thank you.
She is a representative of the American government.
No. I have a lot of different hats on today. Yeah. Well, I don't know that of any way that the U.S. has deliberately sought to fan the flames of oppression against women. I do know that they did support Zia ul-Haq, as you've mentioned, and I think that was just a case, you know, which is often the case in U.S. foreign policy and probably in Dutch foreign policy as well, that the national interest, what the perceived national interest, which was to support the jihad against the Soviet Union, led them to sideline their interest in women's rights, the U.S. interest in women's rights, and to, you know, to put that first. And so they did channel massive amounts of foreign aid towards Zia ul-Haq because he was willing to support the Afghan guerrillas against the Soviet Union, and that was more important to the U.S. than supporting women's rights, you know. And I think that's, you know, been a...
Well, I mean, I think Saudi Arabia is a case in point when it comes to defending human rights, women's rights, and when there are other interests at stake. I think we have time for two more questions. You already had a question, so I'm going to be strict. There's a question over there. I have one slot for a woman, yes. The gentleman over there and one...
Hi, Deborah. Surprise from Prague. I really did enjoy the book. I really enjoyed the part about Aafia probably the most. Both sections were very interesting. But as I was reading the book, and I wanted your opinion about where do you think this war on terror is actually going, I had the feeling that it was somehow a time warp. You know, that this very strange period has passed in a sense, hopefully. And in your discussion, you said that this Al-Qaeda was a relatively small group. And in the book, many of the people have been apprehended, jailed, caught, sidelined. And I just wanted your opinion. Do you think that the war on terror is something that we're moving away from, hopefully? I mean, obviously, with the Arab Spring and stuff, we're going into a different phase. But has that Al-Qaeda-dominated hysteria that we went through for the past 10 years or so, might that be easing a little bit and changing?
I do think so. I'd be interested to hear what you think as well. But I do think, in fact, just today I was reading I got a copy of the book, The 9/11 Wars, which is a term I actually like a lot. Jason Burke, my colleague at The Observer, has written a book, and he talks about how over time what's happened is the local has triumphed over these global cosmic ideas of the war, and people have come to realize that all of these things are much better seen as local fights. And I think here in the Netherlands, people have seen that as well. I mean, they've stopped looking at Dutch Muslims as part of this great mass and much more as the Muslim citizens of the Netherlands who have their own discrete problems and history and have to be viewed individually. And so that whole concept of the war on terror as a global thing is really kind of fading.
Are you optimistic?
Yeah, kind of.
But it's really interesting to see how 9/11 is the watershed for us. I lived in the 90s in Egypt. I worked in the tourism industry. The people in Luxor and at the Red Sea knew about terrorism long before our headlines were talking about it, and they suffered. More Muslims suffered from this whole Al-Qaeda and all their franchises. So I think this is something I always felt was missing in the discussion here. It's all of a sudden it became our war on terror, whereas there was in Pakistan, in Saudi Arabia, in so many countries with Muslim majorities, terrorism attacks have killed many, many people and have also really hurt economies. So we were not the only ones who were afraid of this, and we're not the only ones who want this terror to disappear. But of course, there are always people, individuals, who can create a lot of
havoc.
Yes. Yeah. One last question. Oh, this is difficult. Yes, I like this lady over there. I'm going to be discriminatory. Yes, it's the lady with the white t-shirt. I'm sorry for making a joke about this. But.
Thank you. I'm Marianne Lucas. I worked for some 10 years in Pakistan and Kashmir. And I must say, I'm a bit worried about your answer that you are optimistic. I'm not optimistic at all. If you see what's happening in Pakistan, we talked so far about what is happening to us here in the West. But if you see what's happening to Pakistan, right. You know, it is going on. People are bombed. People are not taken serious. I really agree with the gentleman who said, look at what's happening, or how we in Pakistan have the secular ideology and dreams. Mm-hmm. There's no space for that here in the West. And what I like about your book is that Aafia Siddiqui gets a face and also who she is. But in Pakistan, they know her and they don't see her as the daughter of the nation because of some kind of irrealistic passion or something, but it is also some kind of emotion to protest, and I think it is also a dangerous emotion. It's also an emotion in politicians like Imran Khan. You mentioned him in the book, and Imran Khan is in the West. He is known as a cricketer. Mm-hmm. But it is not known that he is a staunch supporter of Aafia Siddiqui, Saint mm-hmm. Siddiqui. Mm-hmm. And so in this sense, I thank you for the book, but it is the start of a discussion, I hope. Mm-hmm. And for me, I'm not optimistic at all, I must say. So I think we have to see not only what has been done to us mm-hmm. by them, but also mm-hmm. what we do to them. Right. And so then you get some kind of balance to see, or to get some kind of wholeness to see what's happening. And I don't know if I get some optimism then. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, when I say I'm optimistic, I'm fair enough. I was really referring to the gentleman's question and more about the end of the war on terror. But I have to say that I share your concerns about Pakistan. And I do think that Aafia, the reason people respond the way they do to her in Pakistan, or one of the reasons, is because she's seen as a symbol of Pakistan, and the way that people feel that Pakistan has been sort of a helpless victim of the West, trampled on. There's a sort of iconic picture of Aafia when she was in the police station and she was beaten and she sort of crumpled. And that's the picture that Imran Khan at his rallies, that everyone waves around. So it is very worrying and about Pakistan. I agree with you there.
Well, on that rather realistic, somber, pessimistic note, whatever adjective you like, I would like to thank our guest speaker, Deborah. Thank you very much for your speech. And I enjoyed reading the book, even though it upset me at times for many reasons. But why would we want to read books which we totally agree with? So thank you very much. A warm applause for Deborah.
There you go. Bye. Mwah. Thank you. Hi.
Could you sign this one, please? Sign it, or do you want to?
Yeah.